It is my pleasure to open the next session of Quark conference. Today we have a talk by Professor Dmitry Kozakov. He will tell us about high energy behavior of a scattering amplitude in non-renormalizable series. Please, 30 minutes.
So I will talk about non-renormalizable theories. And first of all, I'd like to start with some motivation for this. So you know that the standard model is renormalizable, and we don't know actually whether this is a gift of nature or probably it's effectively renormalizable, so that non-renormalizable interactions exist just simply at the low energies, they do not play any role. But it's very tempting to try to work with non-renormalizable theories anyway. And we know that gravity is not renormalizable. So if you'd like to do something with gravity, there are many ways, many approaches to gravity, but maybe one of them is just to know how to work with non-renormalizable theories. So usually these theories are not accepted in particle physics for two reasons. The first reason is very serious, because there are ultraviolet divergences and somehow they are not under control. You need infinite number of degrees of freedom to fix all the arbitrariness. And the second problem, which is probably more mild, is that the amplitudes in these theories, they increase with energy. That is quite natural, because the coupling is usually dimensionful. It has negative dimension. And so to compensate it, we have energy. And so the amplitudes grow with energy and violate unitarity. So we know that that happened in the old theory of weak interactions, for instance. So this problem is probably easier. And essentially, I will talk about this part of the problem. So from this point of view, we have to know how to calculate, how to handle these quantum corrections. And we know that, first of all, we have to get rid of infinities, and you can do it with the help of the renormalization operation. And we know that renormalization operation itself works in any theory, whether it is renormalizable or not, it doesn't matter. We can subtract all divergences, we introduce counter terms, and eventually all these divergences are local. So the counter terms are local, and that is very important. So in local field theory, all divergences, ultraviolet divergences are local. What does it mean? That means that they are either some constants times fields, or they can have dependence on momenta, but this dependence only polynomial in each order of perturbation theory. That is very essential, so they are non-local singularities. So these properties of theories, again, doesn't matter whether it's renormalizable or not, allows one to write down what we usually call the renormalization group equations. That means that if we do renormalization, say multiplying by some renormalization constant, which is equivalent to introduction of the counter terms, then you can modify this counter terms. This is a continuous operation. And this continuous operation is a group. And we know that in the renormalizable case, it's a group of multiplication. In non-renormalizable case, it's a more complicated. It's not simple multiplication, I will show you. But still it's a group, or better to say it's semi-group, because there is no inverse operation in this case. So it's a semi-group, but still allows you to write down the renormalization group equation, which play the same role everywhere. They sum up the leading divergences. And this can be done in non-renormalizable theories. I will show you many examples how it can be done. Technically, it's more complicated, but it can be done. So my talk is based on the series of papers with my co-authors. They are written below. These papers are devoted to the derivation of these relations and an analysis of these relations. And we continue this, and I will report today several results which are not yet published, but they're on the way. So again, let me start with the renormalization procedure. We introduce some counter terms, then we usually look for the Green function, but in what follows, I will not look simply at the Green function, I will look on the amplitude on shell. So that will be, in fact, this is important enough to have finite amplitudes on shell and not just the abstract Green function. So my object will be the on shell scattering amplitude, and in particular, I will consider 2x2 scattering amplitude. And so this scattering amplitude depends on kinematical variables, usually Mandelstam variables, STU. And then it's some tree level, then there are radiative corrections. We have expansion over the coupling. So in this coupling, and this expansion allows you to do renormalization order by order in perturbation theory and introduce subdivergences and all this machinery, which is well known in the renormalizable case, but in fact, it equally works in a non-renormalizable case. But the difference is that it's no more the simple multiplication. The reason why it's not a simple multiplication is because the counter terms now, because of this dimension of the coupling, which is non-renormalizable theory, these counter terms depend on momenta. And usually they are polynomials on momenta. And if you introduce the subdivergence, it depends on the momenta, which are external for this sub-diagram, but they're internal for the whole diagram. That means that you have to integrate over this momenta. So it's not a simple multiplication of divergences, but you have to take this the sub-divergence, depending on momenta, integrate this momenta through the remaining loop. Sometimes this a polynomial, they cancel some internal lines of the diagram, and this is shown at the bottom of my slide, which is in the case of a gauge theory, where you have some box diagram, and then you have a one loop counter term, which depends on S and T, which are Mandelstam variables. And so when you when you plug in this one loop counter term into this box in order to get two loop divergence, it cancels some lines in this box, and you have triangles. So if it would be simple multiplication, you just have a divergence of a box, but this is not the case. So I don't want to go into technical details, but just give you a flavor of what is happening. So the operation is not a simple multiplication anymore, but it is technically, in principle, we know very well how to do it for each particular diagram. Some problem is how to do it in general, how to write some general formula for this operation, which is not simple multiplication, but for derivation of the relations, which I will present you, I know how to do it. Right, so let me now say a few words about the structure of these local counter terms. So when you calculate some amplitude and then I use dimensional regularization. So my divergences, which are poles over epsilon, one over epsilon to some power in n loops is epsilon to the power n. And then you calculate it, the diagram itself. And this is denoted here like a n with n. So n is loops in the diagram, and then you do, and then you start doing subtraction of subgraphs. And when you subtract the subgraph, you take some contribution of the counter term, and you shrink this subgraph in the diagram, and you get the diagram with the number of loops which is less than the original one. So if you subtract one loop counter term, you have n minus loop diagram, which is remained. If you subtract two loop counter term, you have n minus two loops remained. If you subtract n minus one loop counter term, you have just one loop remaining. And so these are the terms which are written here, just correspond to these subtractions. Again, there is nothing special in it. It is how it works. But this main statement of the renormalization theorem of Bogoliubov and Parasyuk is that this expression must be local over momenta. What does it mean? It is local. That means that if you expand over epsilon, you should not have terms like log of mu. Mu is some scale, of course, it's mu over some S or T or some momenta, which is in the diagram. So you don't have log of mu in your expression. They must cancel. So if you have N loop, you have N minus one equation. So you have N equations and you have N minus one, you have N minus one equation and you have N variables. And so you can express one in terms of the other. And so the solution of this recurrency is that the leading pole, leading term of the diagram itself, which is called a n to n, is related to the one loop counter, one loop diagram, which is remained after subtraction of n minus loop counter term. So this can be done starting from one loop. So you start with one loop, you get two loop term, you start with two loops, you get three loops, and so on and so forth. It's some recurrence relation. And what is important here that starting from one loop diagram, you can go further, further and further and calculate all the leading divergences. So no surprise in the renormalizable case, because we know very well that in the renormalizable case, leading divergences via renormalization group are related to one loop beta function. So, but this is true everywhere. So all higher, all leading divergences or highest order poles are related to the one loop diagram. It can be algebraically calculated from one loop diagram. And these recurrence relations. So let me show you how it works in two loop example. I take phi to the fourth theory. I take this diagram, which is double divergence. So you see it's a second order pole and the first order pole. So what I call the leading divergence is a second order pole. And then I do a renormalization operation. I subtract one loop counter term. So it's written explicitly here. And then you expand over epsilon. And of course you have this log mu term, which must cancel. And from the cancellation of log mu, you have a relation between the leading divergence in two loops, A22, and the divergence in one loop, A11. So it's just the square of it. And this is a typical situation in renormalizable theories. It's simply square. And if you have cubic term, it's a cube and so on and so forth. And you have a just geometrical progression. And we know that the leading divergences are always summed up in the theory we have one coupling like phi to the fourth or the gauge theory. They always summed up into geometrical progression because of this property. But this is also true in case of non-renormalizable theory. It's not so simple relation anymore, but still it can be calculated starting from one loop. So let me show you how this R operation works in the theories which I consider. So I consider basically theories with either cubic couplings or quartic couplings. For instance, phi to the fourth has only quartic coupling. Gauge theory has both cubic coupling and quartic coupling. So, and in these two cases, this R operation works slightly differently on pictures. You see that in one case, you have only bubbles in one loop. In the other case, you have triangles, but in principle, it doesn't matter. You should have either that, or in case of a gauge theory, you should have both. So this is how R operation works. And the leading divergence, what is called here N loop, is related to the one loop diagram with a subtraction n minus loop counter term. And this allows us to write the relation, these recurrence relations, which relate the divergences of one loop with two loop with three loop with four loop, and so on and so forth. So this is how this recurrence relation is written in pictures. So what is shown here? So on the left hand side, this is the leading divergence in n loops, multiplied by n. And to the right-hand side, you see the leading divergence is n minus one loop times one loop diagram. And plus you have a sum of divergences when you get this n minus one loop of combination of different diagrams standing to the left and to the right. So in fact, quite simple relation. In the renormalizable case, these bubbles are just constants. And so you have just simple multiplication. So you have algebraic relation. And from this algebraic relation, in particular in phi to the fourth theory, you have this geometrical progression. In general, this algebraic relation is maybe more complicated. So it's not always geometrical progression. But in case of non-renormalizable theories, everything is the same, but these bubbles now are, these blobs now are functions of momenta. They are polynomials of momenta. And so you do not simply multiply this blob times one loop diagram. You have to integrate this momenta through this one loop diagram. So this is a complication, but in principle it works. And of course, these recurrence relations now you cannot simply solve. But fortunately, you can make your life a bit easier. You can convert the recurrence relation into differential equation. And this differential equation is exactly a renormalization group equation.
So to show how this differential equation look like, it is shown here. So I take the sum with some parameter z, and then it's a differential equation with respect to z. In fact, this z is related to the singularities, but singularities are related to logs of the scale. So in fact, d over dz is d over d log mu, and d over d log mu is just what we have in familiar renormalization group equation. So this equation is shown here for the amplitude. And this is the integral relation now, because we have to integrate this singularity through the diagram. In case of renormalizable theory, these integrals drop and you just have algebraic equation as a typical renormalization group equation for the amplitude with quadratic right-hand side. But here it's a more complicated, and I will show you technically how all this looks for a particular non-renormalizable theory. So I will consider several examples. So first example will be maximally supersymmetric gauge theory in 6, 8, and 10 dimensions, supersymmetric Young-Mills. Well, it's a quite complicated theory, of course. And the reason why I take this example is just because of numerous constellations which take place in the theories, many terms drop, and in fact, equation comes to be easier than the usual theory. So the second example will be phi to the fourth theory, also in various dimensions. So it's renormalizable in 4 and non-renormalizable in higher dimensions. So we'll consider some equations in arbitrary D. Then I'll say a few words about pure gauge theory in dimensions 4, 6, and 8. So in 4 dimensions, it's renormalizable, asymptotically free, but we can write down it in higher dimensions as well. And my last example will be supersymmetric West-Zumino model, but not will cubic interaction, but the quartic interaction. It contains some surprises which we find out, so I say a few words about. Of course, all these models are just the toy models, because the real aim would be probably to do the same thing in quantum gravity, and this is our aim. But for the moment, we play with these toy models and found out there are many interesting properties over these theories, even in the toy model case. So now the scalar theory first. For the scalar theory, I consider 2 by 2 scattering amplitude. So Mandelstam variables STU, you have S channel, T channel, and U channel. And of course, the total amplitude is the sum of all these channels, and typical diagrams in S channel are shown in this slide. So it's phi to the fourth theory. And as I say, we can see that it's on shell. So all masses are zero, all P squares to the external legs are zero. So everything depends just on ST and U. And our goal is to write down these recurrence relations and the renormalization group equations in higher dimensions. So this is how in pictures this R operation works. And the recurrence relation is shown below. And you see it's quite a complicated thing. And let me just try to explain you why it's so complicated. First of all, the first part is when you have to integrate through one loop diagram, n minus loop diagram, and this is the line which is the first line, and x is just Feynman parameter. When you integrate over the loop, you introduce Feynman parameter, and this is the Feynman parameter. So if d equal 4, so 4-dimensional case, everything drops, integrals drops, s, t, and u are just the discounted terms are just constants, so you have algebraic relation. But in say 6 dimensions, it's already non-trivial because they are polynomials of S, T, and U, and you have to integrate them through. You see that the S channel, the parameter S is constant, but T and U have to be integrated through the loop. So the first term is simpler. It's a linear term which comes through the first diagrams. And the second term is quite complicated and it's non-linear. And this is because when you integrate this momenta comes from both diagrams, from left and right, they intersect. And so this you have to integrate. So technically it's shown here, but in practice, if you, for instance, start as one loop, you calculate one loop diagram, and now you want to calculate two loop divergence, you just plug in this relation and immediately algebraically you get two loop divergence, then you plug in two loop, you get three loops, and so on and so forth. You can do it everything already algebraically because all the relations are there. And so you can convert it into differential and equation, as I said. And you have in this red frame, you have differential equation for the scattering amplitude on shell. In this particular case, gamma S means that is the S channel part of the amplitude. And again, you see that you have this integral form, but if you take four dimensions, everything drops, derivative drop, integral drop, and you have just algebraic relation, very simple, d gamma over d log mu is gamma square, which is a solution of geometrical progression. In six and other dimensions, of course, it's a more complicated thing, but again, you can do it everything algebraically, and you can solve this equation numerically if you like. Now, my second example is supersymmetric theory. Supersymmetric, maximally supersymmetric theory. The simplification is that if you consider four by four scattering amplitude, you have the diagrams which are shown on this plot. So all triangles, on bubbles, everything disappears. You have only boxes. And it's clear from this picture that if you're in four dimensions, there are no divergences, ultraviolet, I mean, because boxes are finite. But in six and eight dimensions, you have divergences which appear from this diagram. So we are looking for these divergences in this six, eight, and 10 dimensions. So these are the diagrams. And then you can write down this recurrence relations. One finds out that in six dimensions, because of the specific of six dimensions, non-linear term doesn't exist, so you have a linear equation. So it's a very simple equation, in fact, what is written here. And the x and y are Feynman parameters when integrate over triangle. And one can try to solve this equation analytically, maybe even, but I don't know how to do it. So it's just a recurrence relation, which you can convert, I will show in a minute, in the integral, into differential equation. In eight dimension, everything is more complicated because nonlinear term is already present. And what is shown is very similar to what we have in phi to the fourth theory. So you have first linear term and then nonlinear term with all these terms. And again, we integrate over the bubble and x is parameter of Feynman parameter. Now you can convert it into RJ equation. You can see equation in a case of six dimensions. This is linear. So one can try to solve this linear equation. And in case of D equal eight, it's nonlinear equation. Again, we try to solve it numerically or try to solve it for a particular set of diagrams for ladder approximation, for instance, and it works. Now, few words about Young-Mills. So in Young-Mills, the situation is more complicated than in supersymmetric Young-Mills for the reason that you don't have simply boxes. You have also bubbles and triangles. So you have many contributions and in principle, everything works the same way, but we have both triple and cubic and quartic vertices. So you have to sum them together. We are still, working on it, though in general, all construction is made, but some coefficients were still struggling. I'm expecting that you will have some asymptotic freedom regime for some particular kinematics, for some particular dimensions. Otherwise, it will be some combinations of zero charge and asymptotic freedom dependence on the kinematics. My last example is Wess-Zumina model in four dimensions. So at last we see how it works in four dimensions. So it's non-renormalizable theory in four dimensions. So in superfields, in phi to the fourth, if in components, if you have the two matter fields here, one is scalar, one is chiral spinor. So you will have phi to the sixth interaction and psi psi phi phi interaction. So both are non-renormalizable. So surprise here was that the superpotential, which is phi to the fourth, is renormalized because we're all used to the fact that due to non-renormalization theorems, superpotential is not renormalized. In fact, it's not a correct statement. It's not an accurate statement. The accurate statement is that if you calculate radiative corrections in this kind of theories, you always have integral over the full superspace, not over the chiral superspace. And this is still true. And for any superpotential for phi to the fourth as well. But then when you have this correction, which is integral over the full superspace, you can have covariant derivatives, which you can extract from this diagram. Yeah, in case of phi cube superpotential, you don't have them because you have no, on dimensional grounds, you don't have them. But here the coupling is dimensionful, it's one over a mass. And so this coupling works like, it works like a parameter which makes it possible to extract the covariant derivative. So it's clear how it works in each diagram. So you have extra covariant derivatives, and these covariant derivatives, they transform the full superspace into the chiral superspace. And so as a result, you have a renormalization of a superpotential. So if you look at the theory in more detail, you will find out that there are two types of four-dimensional amplitude, four-leg amplitude, which are renormalized. So it's a chiral amplitude, which is phi, 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 and it's a mixed amplitude, phi bar, phi, phi. So they're both renormalized, and then you have all these recurrence relations, and you have RG equations. So I showed that below these RG equations, you find out that they're mixed between chiral vertices and the mixed vertices. But anyway, this is again, recurrence relations and RG equations, and everything works the same way. You start with one loop and then you calculate all the leading divergences. So it's interesting to try to solve these equations. For particular case of a bubble series, the solution can be obtained, and you find out the geometrical progression with all the properties of the pole, which is in there, and the S channel, you have a pole, in T channel, U channel, you don't have a pole. So work is in progress. I hope soon we will report all the details of this model. It's quite interesting. Now, as I say,
excuse me, a couple minutes it's left.
Sorry?
It's left a couple minutes.
Yes, I have two slides.
Okay.
Thank you very much. So a few words about general solution of this generalized RG equations. So again, I show here this equation written symbolically, but you can see that the right-hand side is actually the polynomial of the second order. And if you look at the algebraic equation of this type, you find out some general properties of this equation. So everything depends on the roots of the right-hand side. So if you have two real roots, then you can be sure that the solution of this equation is exponent. This exponent is either decreasing or increasing, depending on the theory and depending on the kinematics. And the example of this exponent we have in this supersymmetric Young-Milson six dimensions. So if these roots are degenerate, then there's a full square there, then you have single pole. So you have either asymptotic freedom or you have zero charge. Again, it depends on the kinematic. In one channel, it can be a positive sign, and the other channel is negative sign. And this is an example in phi to the fourth theory in D dimensions where we have this single pole. And then in case when you have two complex roots, then the solution contains infinite number of poles. So infinite number of poles, which reminds you in a sense, infinite number of bound states, like in the string theory. And this is a case of, for instance, supersymmetric Young-Milson eight dimension. And we have this explicit solution for particular set of diagrams and numerical solution of the equation in general. So these are general properties of this theory. So I think we can have even some classification of non-renormalizable interaction depending on how these coefficients are constrained. All right, so I will not show you some examples, but I come to resume. So as you see, the UV divergences in non-renormalizable theories are local and can be removed by local counter terms like in the renormalizable case. Now, the main difference and the constant Z, which renormalization constant, so to say, now depends on kinematics. So it's not like simple multiplication. You have to integrate this kinematics through the remaining diagram. So based on locality and Bogoliubov-Parasyuk theorem, you can construct this recurrence relation, which are always valid, and they define in all loops, and they relate all the leading divergences with one loop diagram. I have to say that if you're looking not for the leading divergences, but sub-leading divergences, then you need two loop diagrams. Everything comes from two loops. This is like in a renormalizable case, one loop beta function give you the leading divergences, two loop beta function give you sub-leading divergences. Exactly the same thing happens in non-renormalizable case. These recurrence relations can be converted into RG equations, just like in the renormalizable theories, but these equations are more complicated. They sum the leading terms, but they have this integral differential form now. So the solution is quite complicated, but it can be done, and we can classify actually the high energy behavior of this theory. That's, I think that when we talk about violation of unitarity and that the amplitudes grow with energy, we have to address this question not before we sum up all the leading terms. So after summation of leading terms, it's a place where you have to address this question of high energy behavior of the amplitudes. You see that the behavior can be different. It can be a pole, it can be exponent, it can be infinite number of poles that have to be analyzed for particular theory. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for your interesting talk. We have 5 minutes for questions. Please raise your hands if you are. There is one question. The questions come from Igor Bandas, please.
Thank you, Irina. Dmitry, my question is about D equal 10 super Young Mills. So you announced it, but did not give any details about 10-dimensional crystal. Does this mean that no miracle appears? That it is more complicated and,
You are talking about supersymmetric case, right?
Yes, yes.
You know, when we use this universal expansion over this amplitude, these people constructed it using Spinor-Helicity formalism, which for D equal 10 was not, honestly speaking, well defined. I think that we discussed with you this topic some time ago. I don't see any progress in this field. So we somehow assumed that it exists, and we assumed that the same kind of diagrams can be applied, but we didn't dig into it. So I cannot say much about it. I would say that what we have found so far, that eight dimension and 10 dimensions are more or less the same, assuming that the formalism works.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can I also say something, Irina?
Yes, please.
So I just want to remind the common wisdom about non-renormalizable theories, and probably Dmitry would agree. So it's true that you can subtract loop by loop all the power divergences, but then you have an infinite number of counter terms, and that means that the theory has an infinite number of coupling constants. And all these counter terms, they blow up simultaneously at some energy, for gravity that's Planck mass, for Fermi interaction that's 100 GeV, for chiral, effective chiral theory, that's 1 GeV. And then you don't have a control, you cannot predict the amplitudes or whatever beyond this barrier, because it depends on the infinite number of coupling constants. So do you agree, Rima?
No, I completely agree with you. Indeed, at the very first slide I mentioned that there are two main obstacles. And I will talk about the second one, somehow ignoring the first one, which we may say that if you ignore it, you have nothing, in fact, because you don't have a theory. So somehow I don't have any real answer to this problem. I thought about it a lot, and I have an impression that probably still something can be done, but of course, to fix the infinite number of counter terms, it's not enough to fix some number, it's probably needed to fix some function, which may be expanded with Taylor series and have infinite number expansion terms. So how to do it or how precisely we have to deal with this, I don't know. So this problem for the moment, I better say nothing.
Okay, thank you.
But I agree with you completely.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we left 1 minute for a very short question, please.
May I have a very brief question?
Yes, please, Dima.
I don't know whether my question makes sense, but for example, if we would like to calculate, for example, quartic interaction and higher dimensional scalar theory, and for example, we would like to calculate Coleman-Weinberg potential in non-renormalizable theory, what will your approach show in that case? So will we
Special? Believe it can be done, but what we did so far is not exactly the same, because when you calculate effective potential, you have infinite number of legs. And moment equals zero. We somehow consider the arbitrary momentum, but the number of legs is fixed. So these two problems are related, but they are not exactly the same. So I hope that you can more or less move in that direction as well, but we didn't do it so far.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the time is over. Let's thank once again Dmitry for his interesting talk, and thank people who ask questions. Okay, thank you very much.